Provisions were scanty, ammunition was scarce, and help was nowhere in sight when 185 Texans barricaded themselves in an old mission and fought a 4,000-man Mexican army. During the 12-day siege prior to the final battle, the gallant Americans reinforced the walls, dug trenches, and mounted their 18 cannon while being harassed around the clock by Mexican rifle and artillery fire and scouting parties. I feel confident that the determined valor and desperate courage heretofore evinced by my men will not fail them in the last struggle, and although they may be sacrificed to the vengeance of a Gothic enemy, the victory will cost so dear that it will be worse for him than defeat. God and Texas, victory or death. So ended the final plea for assistance from the Alamo's commander, Colonel William Travis. After rejecting the Mexican demand for unconditional surrender, Travis assembled his men, including the legendary Jim Bowie and Davy Crockett, and offered them the choice of fighting to certain death or leaving the fort. All chose to stay except for one man who managed to escape through the tightening Mexican encirclement. No other defender would remain alive. On March 6, 1836, the Mexican army, commanded by General Antonio Lopez de Santa Anna, attacked the fort from three sides. Twice the Texans repulsed them with bullets and cannon, but sheer numbers finally permitted the Mexicans to gain the walls and pour into the fort. The Texans, out of ammunition, used their rifle butts for clubs as they fought hand to hand. Those who survived the assault on the walls retreated slowly, desperately fighting from room to room in the barracks. Although certain Mexican officers requested clemency for the last surviving Americans, Santa Anna ordered them massacred. Mexican soldiers tossed the Texans' bodies on their bayonets as if they were bales of hay. As a final insult, the Mexicans stripped and burned the corpses. Although outnumbered 20-1, the Alamo defenders indeed made Mexico pay a heavy price. At least 1,500 Mexicans were killed or wounded, and Santa Anna's advance into Texas was delayed for 2 weeks, which gave Texas enough time to gather an army that defeated Mexico 2 months later. 13 months after the Alamo fell, Texas declared its independence from Mexico's repressive dictatorial rule, which not only had denied Texas such rights as statehood, trial by jury, public education, and religious freedom, but it also prescribed slavery. When I was about 5 years old, my folks took me to the Alamo, and I remember it having a very distinct impression on me, which I've kept for most of my life. So over the next month, I'm going to be doing five games that involve the Texas Revolution. That would be three games that have to do with the Alamo, and two that have to do with the overall battles of the Revolution itself. This week, I'm going to start with SPI's 1981 game, The Alamo. And it was designed by Eric Lee Smith and was also produced under the name The Alamo, Victory and Death. I think that was by SPI. It's since been re-released by Decision Games. I think initially this was a magazine game, but it was actually released as a box game also. And it was kind of made, I think, during SPI's last days. So it was a little bit different than former SPI games. It has a kind of interesting map that Redmond Simonson made. It's kind of an orthographic view of the Alamo. Like most Redmond Simonson maps, I think they're kind of an acquired taste. However, once you get into them, I think you'll kind of like them. Over time, my opinion has changed a great deal, and now I really like these type of maps. For those interested in the scales on this game, each fire point of a Texian unit represents one man. Each Mexican unit represents between 45 and 55 troops. A hexagon on the map represents 10 yards from hex side to hex side, and each game turn represents about 5 minutes. Now, historically, the assault itself lasted only about 90 minutes, so when you play this game out, it actually comes out a little bit short. The game ends when the Texian player has eliminated a decisive number of Mexican troops, or when the Mexicans have eliminated the entire Texian force. Now, to set up the game, the Texian player places their artillery face up on each hex with an artillery symbol. The artillery consists of 5 4-pounders, 6 6-pounders, 3 8-pounders, 2 12-pounders, and the famous 18-pounder that was involved in the battle. That's pretty close to the historical records, which show sort of similar guns. Now, each Mexican counter belongs to a column represented by a number or a letter, and that's a 1 through 4, and then there's the letter R for reserve units. The Mexican player secretly plots their entry areas for each column on a piece of scratch paper, and columns 1 through 4 interplay the first round, while the reserve column enters after a Mexican unit has set foot in the plaza of the Alamo. Now, only one column can be plotted per entry area, except for the reserve, which can come in any entry area. For solitaire play, I just roll d6 to determine where these columns come in. The Texian player then places their counters within the Alamo compound. Now, only one combat unit can be placed per hex, and leaders can be stacked with combat counters, guns, or other leaders in a single hex. You place Jim Bowie in hex 1717, and he stays there as he was sick throughout the siege. Texian counters can never leave the Alamo confines. And when I say the Alamo confines, that includes all hexes enclosed by walls, as well as the cattle pen and the churchyard hexes. The fourth step of setup is the Mexican unit placement, and the Mexican player places their units in the entry areas that they've secretly selected. While there is a limit of one combat unit per hex side, leaders can be stacked with combat units. The reserve units are placed at the side of the board until a Mexican unit enters the plaza, as I just mentioned, and then they can come in. Now, looking at the units, each Texian combat counter has three numerical ratings for morale, fire strength, and melee strength, and the Mexican combat units have only one number for all three of these. Now, the morale rating is used when you make damage checks. The fire strength is used when you use the combat results table to determine the effects if a unit hits an enemy unit. Melee strength is the measure of a combat unit in a hand-to-hand combat, and it's used with the combat results table to determine the effects of melee combat. That is when two units are in adjacent hexes fighting each other. The leadership rating of the leadership units is used to modify damage checks. Now, all units in this game have a movement allowance of 8 movement points. Not 8 hexes, but 8 movement points. And like most other war games, you'll use a train effects chart to determine how much it costs to move from hex to hex. Combat units have a front and a back side, and they're flipped if they take damage. Combat units can take 2 hits before they're being eliminated. Mexican leader units have an alternate leader on the back side, while Texian units leader units do not. When Mexican leaders are killed, you can flip the unit over to its backside, while with the Texian leaders, they're simply eliminated from the game. Finally, Mexican units also have a column number that's used during the game setup. Like all war games, there's a sequence of play, and it starts with the Texian movement phase, and then there's a Texian combat phase, and then the Texians can rally units that have failed morale checks for some whatever reason. Then there's a Mexican reserve commitment phase. I'll talk about that. A Mexican movement phase, a Mexican combat phase, and then a Mexican rally phase. There's also a Mexican withdrawal check phase in the game, and this is used to see if the Mexicans would lose if they take a certain number of casualties. However, it kind of appears to be broken. For instance, in the first turn, the Mexicans can take up to 350 casualties. However, there's a maximum of 170 potential casualty points on the board in the first turn. So I just delete this mechanic. It doesn't really add much to the game. Finally, there's a little bit of housekeeping. There's a game turn indication phase where you move the game turn marker forward. Then you move into a Mexican replacement phase and finally a Mexican reserve phase, where you bring replacement and reserve units back. So most of these turns begin with a movement phase. And as I said before, each unit can move up to 8 movement points in a turn. The number of movement points a unit must expend is determined by the terrain, and this is listed on the terrain effects chart under the column movement point cost to cross. If a unit doesn't have enough points to cross to the next hex side, it has to stop. So for example, the Mexican units would need 4 movement points to get atop one of the mission's outer walls. So moving up to the wall, they'll probably have to stop and climb the wall on the next turn. Now, units can move through hexes occupied by other friendly units, but they don't stack in those hexes. They have to keep moving. Units cannot move through a hex occupied by an enemy unit, and they have to stop if they enter the zone of control of the enemy unit. Now, an exception to this is a unit that enters a hex containing an unaccompanied enemy artillery battery or an unaccompanied leader. And in these cases, either the battery is captured or the leader is killed, respectively. Now, artillery batteries and leaders are not considered combat units, and thus they can freely be stacked with other combat units. The zones of control are pretty typical of war games. It's the 6 hexes surrounding a unit, and they don't extend across certain types of terrain hex sides, which is mostly walls and gun slits. Now, zones of control are sticky, and units cannot leave a zone of control of an enemy unit except as a result of combat. An exception to this is if Mexican units occupy the zone of control of a Texian unit. In this case, A second Mexican unit is unaffected by the Texian zone of control, and it can enter, move through, or leave the zone of control of that Texian unit. A unit in an enemy zone of control can only engage in melee combat, and this applies to all units. Thus, Mexican units in a Texian zone of control may not engage in fire combat, even though there may be more than one Mexican unit in the zone of control. Artillery can't fire on an enemy unit in its zone of control. In other words, artillery can't fire on an adjacent unit. Zone of controls can stop enemy units from crossing walls. Thus, if a unit is trying to cross a wall and doing so would put it in the zone of control of an enemy unit, it shall not pass. If a unit's routed, it no longer exerts a zone of control. Terrain and line of sight are kind of important in this game, and supposedly these were some rules that kept this game sidelined for a long time. The rules themselves, as written, are not that great, so I've kind of had to improvise a little bit. What I've done is I say units have to have a clear line of sight to an enemy unit that they're firing upon, and the enemy unit must be within range. For range, I say that artillery has an unlimited range, and small arms have a 7-hex range limit. Units can't fire through or over outside walls or buildings, such as the chapel, and units can fire from the tops of walls to the area lower or to another wall or building top. In other words, they can fire from the outside wall to another area on the outside wall or to the top of the chapel. Units can also fire from the ground to the tops of buildings. Also note that friendly units block the line of sights of units firing from other units at the same level. However, they do not block units firing from wall tops to the ground or from the ground to a wall top. In other words, a Mexican unit firing from the ground could fire over a friendly unit if it was targeting a Texian unit on top of the outer walls. Exterior fire can only enter the interior building through door hexes or breaches, and low walls, like the one near the cattle pens, churchyard, and cemetery, affect combat, but they don't block the line of sight. So, in other words, they do affect your chances of hitting, but they don't block the line of sight. There are two types of combat in this game, fire and melee. Both are resolved using the same procedure. Each combat unit in the game has two combat strengths. Its fire strength is used if it's attacking units more than a hex away, and its melee strength is used when attacking enemies in adjacent hexes. Artillery units only have a fire combat strength, and they can't attack units in adjacent hexes. During a turn, a unit may only engage in either melee or fire. They can't engage in both during the same turn. Each unit makes a separate attack on a single enemy during combat, and several units are not able to combine their strengths when attacking. They can all attack singly, but they can't gang up. Routed units cannot attack, and disordered units can only attack at half strength. And units may not use fire attack if they're in the zone of control of an enemy unit. They can only use melee attacks in this particular situation. Units may melee across low walls, but they can't melee across exterior walls, interior walls, or gun slits. Now, the combat resolution procedure is a little different than most other games. I think it's a little overly complicated. First, you determine if the attacker hits the defender. And to do this, you locate the row within the terrain that the defending unit occupies. And then you cross-index with the fire melee strength of the attacker. And this will indicate the column that you will use for the die roll. So, for example, if a Mexican unit with a fire strength of 8 attacks a Texian unit on top of an outer wall, you find the row with outer wall and index across to the 8 to determine the column that you're going to use for the attack. You then roll a die 6 to see if the attack is successful, and you look down the column indicated in this above step, and you follow it down to the row that has a die roll indicated. The cross index value will then indicate the result of the attack. Now, the little minus sign or dash means the attack was ineffective, and H is a hit, and the attack has succeeded, and the defending player will then make a damage check. A number is a hit, and since it succeeds, you add the number to the damage check as a modifier. And finally, the C, which is kind of interesting, is a counterattack. And counterattacks mean the attack's failed, and the defending unit gets a free attack back on the attacker, either by melee or fire attacks respectively. Now note that this can result in a counterattack to the counterattack, and that all such attacks do not count against the limit of one attack per turn. You could go back and forth between units counterattacking each other, but that would not affect the overall limitations of attacks. If a unit were in the zone of control of an enemy unit and it was fired upon by a second unit and it received a counterattack result, it would be unable to counterattack the firing unit because of the restriction on firing from an enemy zone of control. In the above example, if the Mexican unit attacking rolled a 3, the result would be an H, which would indicate a hit against the Texian unit. You roll 2d6 and add a specific modifier to see what kind of damage is inflicted on the defending unit. Now, the modified result is compared to the defending unit's morale, and the following potential results are obtained. First, if the sum is less than the unit's morale, there's no effect. Second, if the sum exceeds the unit's morale by 1, the unit becomes disordered. Third, if the sum exceeds the unit's morale by 2, the unit takes a step loss and is disordered. Third, if the sum exceeds the unit's morale by 2, the unit takes a step loss and is disordered. And the unit's flipped over to its backside to indicate this step loss, and a disoriented marker is placed on it. If the unit's already been reduced, then a second step loss eliminates it. If the sum exceeds the unit's morale by 3 or more, the unit is immediately eliminated. A unit which is disordered and which receives a second disorder result is routed, and it has to retreat 3 hexes. And a routed unit that receives a disordered result remains routed and retreats an additional 3 hexes. Also remember, any time a unit's eliminated or forced to retreat because of melee, the attacker may freely enter the hex that unit occupied. Going over the damage check modifiers, obviously the values that result on the CRT are added to the damage roll. And if a unit is with a leader and is attacking, you can add that leader's leadership value to the damage roll. If a unit is with a leader and it's defending, you can subtract the leader's leadership value from the die roll. And if there's an unrouted, undisordered combat unit within the grounds of the plaza of the Alamo, all Mexican attacks add 1 to their damage roll for their attacks, and all Texian units subtract 1 from their attacks. +1 is added to the Mexican attacks for each Mexican unit in a Texian zone of control if a number of Mexican units are attacking that same unit. Real quick on disordered. Disordered doesn't happen a lot during the game, and routes are even rarer. Until its rally, during its rally phase, a unit which is disordered is subject to the following limitations. The unit's fire and melee strengths are halved, and you can round fractions up. Its movement point is reduced to 4, so in other words, it's halved. The unit can't fire artillery. If it gets a second disorder result, it's routed, and it has to retreat. The unit can't counterattack, and the unit adds 2 to any additional damage checks as long as it remains disordered. If it's routed, it has to retreat 3 hexes. If it receives another disorder result, it retreats another 3 hexes. It can't move, it has no zone of control, it can't engage in combat, and it can't counterattack. And it also adds 2 to its damage checks. Now, an artillery battery can never retreat or be eliminated, but it may be taken over by an enemy combat unit. A leader may retreat only if he's stacked with friendly combat units that retreat. And a retreating unit must always move away from an attacker and can't enter the zone of control of another enemy unit. If it's unable to meet these 2 rules, it's eliminated. For example, if it were cornered in a room or couldn't climb a wall to get away. If a friendly unit retreats into the hex containing another friendly unit, that unit also routes. So it's possible for these chain reaction routes to be caused, and each unit would then have to retreat 3 hexes. Now, if a Mexican unit is in an entry area hex and it's forced to retreat, it's eliminated. And if it was at full strength at the time of elimination, you place it on the 2 space of the replacement track, which I'll talk a little bit about, and you record 2 casualties on the Mexican casualty track. If the unit's at a reduced strength when it's eliminated, you place it in the 3 space of the replacement track, and 3 casualties are recorded. Couple notes on artillery. Either side can use them. They can be used to fire, but never melee, or they can be used to breach walls. Now, batteries can only move and or be fired if they're stacked with a combat unit. They can't fire on their own. To fire a battery, a combat unit of either side must be given its friendly combat phase in the same hex with the battery. A battery can be moved up to 4 hexes by an unrouted or undisordered Mexican combat unit when the Mexican movement phase begins. Now, the Mexican unit's movement is reduced to 4 for that movement phase, and they can only move through clear terrain and on gun ramps. Only once during the game can a Texian player move a battery, and they can only move it 1 hex. One thing that combat units can do is if they're stacked with a battery, they can also engage in fire combat. Thus, a unit may fire twice in a single combat phase, first from the battery that it's serving, and then with its own small arms. Now, as I've kind of mentioned before, batteries can't fire if an enemy is adjacent to them. In other words, they can't engage in melee combat. They can fire at walls, however, and create breaches. You roll 2d6, and if the result is lower than the battery's combat strength, then the gun blows a hole in the wall. Now, we've talked about leaders. Let's just talk about how they're killed off. They can be killed by either enemy fire or enemy units moving into their hex. And a leader which is stacked with a unit that takes a step loss or with a unit that's eliminated rolls a d6. If the result's a 1, the leader's killed. If it's a 2 through 6, there's no effect. If the units that a leader is stacked with are killed during melee, the attacking units may move into that hex and automatically kill the leader. And if a lone leader is fired upon, I just say roll a d6, and if you roll under the leader's morale, that leader is killed. Mexican leaders that are killed are flipped over to the replacement side, and they're placed on the replacement track in space 3. And if the replacement is killed, then you flip it over, place it on... Well, you don't flip it over, because that's the last one it has. You just place it in space 2. It's assumed that some unnamed person has risen to the Mexican leadership position. Now, remember, leader units are not combat units, and they can't man artillery batteries by themselves. Units are automatically rallied if they're stacked with a friendly leader during the friendly rally phase. I've talked a little bit about rallies. During the rally phase, all friendly units, which are in a disordered status, are rallied, and the disordered markers are removed from the units. All units which are routed have their status reduced to disordered. Now, a unit which is routed but which is stacked with friendly leader during the rally phase is automatically rallied, and the route markers removed altogether. It's not reduced to disordered. Now, one of the interesting things about this game is that the Mexicans can draw from a nearly bottomless supply of men, and they do this through a replacement mechanic. Now, each time a Mexican combat unit's eliminated, you place it on the replacement track, and a number of casualties are recorded on the casualty track equal to its place on the replacement track. Each casualty point represents 10 actual casualties. When a Mexican unit's eliminated, it's eligible to re-enter again on a later game turn. So if a unit is at full strength when eliminated, you place it on the 2 space with its full strength side face up. If it's at a reduced strength and it receives another step loss, it's placed on the 2 space. If a unit's at reduced strength and it receives an elimination result, a 2 or more step loss result, it's placed on the 3 space. It's always placed with its reduced strength side face up. A unit which is eliminated because it's unable to retreat is always placed on the 3 space. Now, every turn, these units are moved up 1 space, and when they reach the 0 space, they can return to any area that the Mexican player chooses. Finally, the Texians have what they call a ferocious counterattack. It can be used under very specific circumstances. For it to happen, the unit must be stacked with a Texian leader at the time of the attacker's counterattack result. So the way this works is the Texian player rolls a dice, and if it's less than or equal to the leader's leadership rating, they engage in the number of counterattacks equal to the leader's rating plus 1. If it's greater, they still get 1 normal counterattack. The Texian unit may fire or melee per the restrictions of fire or melee combat that we've noted above. And should a Texian's ferocious counterattack result in a C result, the result is treated as a no-effect result instead, so the Mexican player doesn't get a counterattack to a ferocious counterattack. A routed or ordered Texian unit which is successful in rolling for ferocious a counterattack is also immediately rallied and can counterattack. Winning the game is based on how many points the Texians get, and it continues until the conclusion of game turn 12 or until all Texian leaders and units are eliminated, whichever comes first. The player then totals the number of victory points and that the Texian player has accumulated. So the Texian player receives 1 victory point for each game turn in which the Texian combat unit or leader is alive at the beginning of the Texian player turn, and they also receive a victory point for every casualty point that's on the replacement chart. If the Texians get 13 or less victory points, then the Mexicans win, and if they get 14 or more, then the Texians win. The Texians can also win automatically if they have combat units or leaders alive at the end of game turn 12. That's kind of the game. I've run through it pretty quick, so let's go ahead and set it up, and I'll run a playthrough for you. Okay, I've gone ahead and set the game up here, and if you want to play along while I'm doing this, go ahead and go down to the link for the Vassal module, and I can wait.
Let's all go to the lobby.
Okay, you should have it up. And like I say, what I've done is I've gone ahead and set up the units. I've placed all the artillery pieces on these little artillery cannons. I then rolled for the Mexican units and placed them on each area where they enter the map. And then I went ahead and placed the Texians in various areas so that they could kind of cover the 4 walls of the Alamo. The only place I left open was Area 6 down here at the, I guess that's the southeast corner of the Alamo. That's down where that 18-pounder is, so probably won't be able to use that during the game, which is too bad, but that's okay. That's where it was traditionally placed, so I thought I'd stick it there. We're going to go ahead and start the Texian movement phase, and looking around, I don't see where the Texians are going to have to move too much. The only place I might move them is this guy could go over here and get some get more shots in, because he's going to be, well, he could do, there's a line of sight. I think this has a line of sight. No, it does not have a line of sight. But I think that would count as the line of sight. Yeah, that's going to count as a line of sight there for that San Luis unit. So I think we're okay. I think we're going to just go ahead and start firing. So we'll start up here with Crockett and this Tennessee unit. I'm going to go ahead and zoom in a little bit. And they've got this 8-pounder. And we're going to fire with it first. So let's go with Jimenez, and an 8-pounder has a combat strength of 7. And we are going to be firing on the clear. So combat strength, let's go ahead. I'll show you on the chart. The clear 7 is going to be right here. So we roll 1d6. Let me push this down a little bit. And we get a 1, which you want to roll low in this. So a 7 and 1 is going to give us a +2 on our attack modifier, or our damage modifier. But we've also got Crockett with us. So that gives us overall a +5. And I was aiming for Jimenez here. So we roll 2d6 +5 is a 9. +5 is a 14. So that's well over +3. So this unit is eliminated. Pull down our record track here. This is good because I get to show you this. He goes to a 2. And we need to get some little game turn markers. Let's put a game turn marker for 1. And we'll put Mexican losses here and a ×10 here. So the Mexican loss on this was 10 casualties. So we're going to put 10 casualties right here. Okay. Then the Tennesseans will fire at Romero. So we are going to, let me just pull this up here. Romero is on a clear terrain, and the Tennesseans have a 9 that they fire with here. So we go a 9 with clear terrain. It's this last column over here. And we roll, and we get another 1. That's a +4, so that's a +4, and then +3 again for being with Crockett, so +7. And Romero subtracts 2, so what did I say here? I'm losing my train of thought here. Oh, I guess I didn't roll. +7 minus +2 is a +5. This is Montemor. We get a 5, and a 5 is a 10. That's a 2 over, and for 2 over, they're going to be disordered, but they don't disorder because they're with an officer, so let's delete that. Oops. This behaves weird. Let's get rid of that. Okay, and then let's flip this. Flip it, disorder, delete, and I think I flipped it. Did I flip it? Yeah, I did. There, it went from an 8 to a 7. Okay. And that's it for these guys. I'm going to go ahead and say they fired. So I'll put a little fired marker on them. Okay, this unknown here is going to fight with a 7. And 7 in a clear is a, it's this column right here. We roll a d6. And we get a 6. So a 6 is an automatic miss in all cases. So they miss when they fire. We mark them as fired. Okay, I think that's 1, 2, yeah. Okay, let's see if these Kentuckians can hit. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's too far for small arms fire, but they can with this 8-pounder. So we're going to check the chart here with a clear breach, 7. We roll a 3, 1, 2, 3, and we get a +1. We get a +1 and then a -2, so a -1. We roll 2d6 and we get a 7. That's equal to, so that's not going to affect Montemore. Okay, so these guys have all done what they can do. This gun can't fire because there's no infantry, there's no units with it, but this guy can. let's see, he's got to be 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's 6. So San Luis, he's got a fire value of 10. Let's go back to our chart here. So 10, oh, that's the last column. And hold on a second. Wait a minute. Oh, that's for the small arms fire. I'm sorry, I'm getting a little confused myself. Okay, we're going to fire with small arms fire first. So we fire with small arms and we get a 5. So that's a plus 1. We roll the 2d6 and get a 10. That's an 11. So that's 3 or more. So these guys are knocked out. And we move our Mexican losses there. Okay, and then Morales. I guess we'll go ahead and fire on Morales here. Oh, and I forgot something here. We had one hit on Romero over here. We need to see if Romero made it through. So we roll a 1d6, and if we get a 1, Romero is eliminated. He's eliminated, so we're going to flip him over, and he's going to become Salas. And we move him to the 2. And actually 3. I think it goes to 3 there. Okay. Now we can go back to Morales and Matamor. So we had an 8. We had a 12-pounder with an 8. An 8 with a 12-pounder. We roll a 1d6. It's clear terrain, so we get a 3. 1, 2, 3. It's a plus 1. And a minus 3, so it's a minus 2. We get a 10 minus 2 is an 8, which is lower than their combat factor, so they're not affected. And that ends these guys. Now, these first rounds will always go the slowest. Okay, the Yanks. Let's see. The Yanks have a 6-pounder where they can fire with, but can they shoot with small arms? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yes, they can. They have a 9. Pull our chart up. And I've got a chart printed here, so I won't refer to this chart as much as the game goes on, but for this first round, at least, I'll use it. Okay, 9. We roll a 1d6 and get a 6, so that's an automatic miss. And then for the 6-pounder, 6, we roll a 4. And that is a hit. No modifier, but the gun hit. We roll 2d6, and we were trying to go after Morales, so it's going to be 2d6 minus 3. 7 minus 3 is 4, so no dice. Okay, Marcus fired. Dickerson will do the same thing. Okay, he's got 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Not enough to hit. Okay, so it's too far off for these Texans to hit, but they can try with their 8-pounder, which has a 7 attack factor. A 7 attack factor, we roll a d6, and we get a 4, which is a hit. Okay. We have a plus 1 with Dickerson, and since we were trying for Morales, and a minus 3. So plus 1 minus 3 is minus 2. We roll 2d6. 3 minus 2 is a 1, so that's not going to do anything. Mark fired. And then finally, the Pennsylvanians. We know they're going to be out of range, but they have this little 6-pounder. The 6-pounder has a 6. We roll a d6, and we get a 3. So a plus 1. And again, Morales. So plus 1 minus 3 is minus 2. 6 minus 2, not enough. I guess we could have tried to shoot the guys on either side, but I'm going to try to bring these officers out if I can. Whoops, I flipped him by mistake. Let's fire him. Okay. Nobody's here. Nobody's here. Okay, we're going to go along the, let's see, that's the north wall. One of my pet peeves with these games is I think north should always be up on a map. That just makes it easier. Also note that I'm out down here. Those are the reserve units, and they will come in once a Mexican unit touches down in the plaza. Okay, Bonham, I'm going to try for Cos. Try to take Cos out. So we'll start with the 4-pounder, and that's a 5. 5 is going to, we roll a d6, and we get a 4. And that's a counterattack. Okay, so This gun here invokes counterattack, and it was costs. Let's see. Actually, it'll be the units on top that'll be attacked. Let's see. So we are in clear terrain, and Aldama has a 9. Oops. Aldama has a 9. It's against the top of a wall, however, here. So we go to the outer wall, and we go over to this column here. We roll a d6 and get a 6. That's automatically going to miss. So they actually avoid being killed off. Okay. However, that was with the cannon. The Louisianans here have an 8 against a clear. An 8 against a clear, and we roll a d6 and get a 2, which is a plus 2. Okay, and they get a plus 2 for bottom, so they get a plus 4, and then a minus 3 for cause. So they get a plus 1. We roll 2d6 and get an 8, which is not, it's under the 9, so they're fine. And let's mark these guys as fired. Okay, Kentuckians. Yeah, go ahead and shoot San Luis here. They got a 12-pounder. So we'll start with the 12-pounder, which is an 8. We roll a d6 and get a 4, which is 1, plus 1. And I was going against these guys, San Luis. We roll a 2d6, a 5, a 6. It's under 7, so nothing. Kentuckians will go with a 9. And we get a 5, so that's a plus 1. And we roll 2d6 and get a 10, 11. Okay, again, more than plus 3, so this unit is sent to the dead pile. And we increase our casualties. Okay, these guys have fired. Okay, the English, can they go ahead? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I say they'll go against Aldama. They have a 7, and they're firing into clear, so they're on this column. We roll a d6 and get a 6, automatic miss. Okay, the New Yorkers. Okay, they're close enough they could get Kaz. I gotta mark these guys as fired. And they have a 9. We roll a d6, and a 5 is a plus 1. We roll 2d6 and get a 10, and cost gives them a minus 3, so that's a 7, so nothing there. Mark moved. Oops, mark fired. That's what I want. Okay, foreigner troops. They do have a cannon. Should I go against these guys? I'm going to go ahead and shoot down up here at Toluca. Yeah, I can do that. It's a little 4-pounder. We check the charts. A 4-pounder has a 5. And we roll a d6. And we get a 2. Okay, 5. And that's a hit. That's simply a hit. So we roll 2d6 and get an 11. Ooh! That's enough to take the Toluca guys out. And then these foreign troops, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, too far for small arms fire. Mark just fired. Travis will then go against Duke. And this is about where Travis was probably killed in the real battle. He was reloading his shotgun and got shot from down below real early in the battle. Okay, so they got a 6-pounder. I should have put an 18-pounder there, I guess. Okay, a 6-pounder. We roll a 1, so that gives us a plus 1. Okay, plus 3 for Travis, so that's plus 4, but you get a minus 2 for Duke, so that's a plus 2. We roll the d6 and get a 9, 10, 11. Okay, that's more than enough, so we mark this. These guys are out. The Mexicans are taking a pretty heavy hit this time. Okay, we get to see if Duke lives. Duke lost. Duke was killed too. Okay. So Castro will replace him. And Texans, that was with a cannon, I think. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Nope, they can't make it. We mark them as fired. Okay, the Missourians will go against San Luis here, this bottom San Luis. They have an 8. We roll a d6, and we get a 8 on a 4 is a plus 1. We roll 2d6 and get a 5. That's a 6. Not going to do anything. And finally, the Ireland guys will go against these North San Luis. They've got a 7 against a clear 7. 6 is automatic miss. Okay, so mark fired. So that ends the Texians' turn. Now the Mexicans can make a movement, and they can move 8. 4. They'll move 4 there. And they will go after Crockett and his group. I think I will let these guys go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. No, they can't make it. So, okay, these guys are going to have to fire on, now the zone of control won't cover these hexes, but they'll have to fire for now, but they'll be able to move up and over the wall next turn. Okay, Koss and his guys. 6, 7, 8, and we will go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We'll try to get out of the fire of all these cannons that are coming at us. Okay. Over on this side, south side, Morales. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. They're going to have to try to push over this wall. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. And that's the movement. Now then, this is automatically forcing, let's go ahead and remove these artillery with the, units. This is going to force a these units to melee. So Crockett and his bunch will melee, and they have a melee strength of 3 to Matamoros' 7, so Matamoros can probably take these guys down pretty easily. So we're going to melee, I think we can melee across these short fences here. Okay. Let's see. Okay, they've got a 7 and a 7 across a fence is, or it's a wooden wall or stone wall. It's going to be this one, and we roll 2d or 1d6 and we get a 2. Okay. So it's a plus 1. Crockett makes it a minus 2. We roll 2d6 and 3, so it's nothing. Okay. We will then try to fight across this fence, and we get a 9. We roll a d6, and we get a 4, or a 9, and we get a 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, plus 1. Plus Morales will give it a plus 3, so that's a plus 4. Against these Yanks here. 2d6, 11 plus 4. The Yanks are gonna be gone. So we just delete them from the game. And I'm gonna say they're gonna hop the fence and move on in, which they can do since this unit was eliminated. Jimenez will fight with a 9. These guys are kind of tough. The chart says a 9 against a stone wall. We roll a d6 and get a 4. It's a plus 1. but we get a Dickerson makes it a subtracts one, so it's at plus three, 2d6, plus three, seven. And they still have a morale value of nine, so they can't do much. Okay. Oh, and then these guys are now in the Alamo proper. The cemetery counts as part of the plaza. There's the plaza and the cemetery. This is in the Alamo. The churchyard and the cattle pen are not. So we need to be adding that plus one, minus one. Okay, Kaz is not going to be able to do anything. San Luis will try to fire up on Ireland here. They got a seven. And this is on a high wall. So this is over in this column. We get a two. So I go seven, two is a hit. Okay, so these guys got a hit. San Luis got a hit here on Ireland. And we do 2d6, 8, 9. Okay, that's plus 2. So these guys are disordered. San Luis will then try to fire up at this guy, which they can do. And they have a 7. Onto a high wall, we roll a d6 and get a 4. That's a miss. Okay. I think that's everybody, and I think that's the turn. So for the end of the turn, what we need to do is remove any Mexican disorders. There are none. We go to the record track, and we move these guys forward, and move this here. We move the game turn forward to round 2, and I'm going to get rid of the moves. We're going to move these guys, the reserve. Where am I going to move my reserve? I'm going to move my reserve in. Now, I'm going to roll. Let's roll for the reserve. Okay, we get a 2. So reserve comes in at 2. They're going to come in up here, which is kind of a weak point. So I think they'll be able to make it. Okay, that's pretty much, I think, it for the round. Anything? Do I see anything? No. Okay. We're in round 2. The Texians can move and fight. Now, they can't move outside the Alamo here. One, I guess this guy could move over here. He may have to. Okay, let's see. Let's look at the chart here. And a stone wall costs a plus 1, so he can easily get there. Okay. So he's going to move his 8, and there's a plus 1. 1, 2, 3, 4. So he's going to be fighting. I'm going to say they're going to be fighting over here. These guys can still move. This guy can move here. So he's going to move over here. Their zone of control doesn't affect these guys. Okay. Bonham is going to run down here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And he's going to bring the Louisianans down with him. And they're going to try to rake this wall. He'll try to stop Kaz. And Travis is going to move over. Let's see. Can I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Nope, he can't make it. I was going to move Travis over here. Okay, what I'm going to do is at one time per game, you can move a cannon. One hex. I'm going to move this 6-pounder here with Travis and his Texans. And we're going to move there. Okay. This guy is going to move 1, 2. Ah, he can't get out. I wonder if he could hop down. 1, 2, 3. He's on the roof. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's going to put him up here. Let's see. Okay, hold on. I got this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Nope, he can't do it either. I'm going to try. I'm going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then he's going to try to jump up here next turn and start firing. And the Virginian is going to move down to this cannon here. Okay, I think I've moved my Texans around a little bit. Disorder guy can't really do much. Okay, let's start back up here. Now, we can't use the gun because we're right next to him. Can't fire. So we're just going to have to melee. And he has a 3. Now, Texians have terrible melee values, so that makes it pretty tough. Okay, so we're fighting across the stone wall with a 3. That's in this first column. We roll a 6, which is automatic. Crockett can't do anything. The 1 can't hit. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to roll d6. A 1 will be an automatic hit no matter what, just to give everybody a fair chance. 2. Nope. Okay. Okay, and then the 7-pounder is going to fire, or the 8-pounder, I'm sorry. The 8-pounder is a 7, so it's clear. We roll a 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. It's a hit. And no pluses. 6, not enough. Boy, if we had a plus 1, that would have been nice. Okay, our plus 2 or 3 would have been even better. Okay, then this guy can shoot with a 10. A 1. He had a 10. And a 1 is a plus 5. That's going to make it tough for Matamore. 11. Oh, yeah, Matamore's just completely blown out of the water there. We'll move him to a 2. Okay. Over here, Dickerson, who am I going to fight? Dickerson's going to fight Morales. He has a 2 that he can fight with since it's a melee. Let's check my chart. 2 against a clear. A 4, nothing. Okay, doesn't do anything. Even with modifiers. The Pennsylvanians against Jimenez. They've got a 3, and it's across a wall. A 3 across a wall. Okay, they could do it. It's in the first column. They roll out 6, automatic miss. They don't do anything. Mark fired. Okay, Bonham. Down here with his gun, and I'm going to say he can fire. It's a 6-pounder, so it's a 6. He's firing on the Aldamas. And a 6-pounder is a 6 is a 2. It's a plus 1. They get a plus 2 for Bonham, so that's a plus 3. We roll an 8, 9, 10, 11. That's enough to send Aldama to the dead pool. Oh, I forgot a 2 losses. Okay, I forgot that 1 set of losses. Okay. And now I'm going to say that Louisiana cannot fire. I'm going to say this is out of range of sight. You're going to have to, with line of sights, you're just going to have to use good judgment. And so I'm going to say that would be pretty hard to fire down that wall onto the ground. I guess they could be leaning out, but that seems like a stretch. Okay, English are going to fire down the wall at Kaz. And they have a 5. The charts will say a 5, and they get a 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, that's a counterattack. So Kaz and his group get to go. Now they have a 9 firing up at the English. And we roll a d6, and we get a 4. Let's see, 9 at the top is this column. One, two, three, four. So it's a hit. Okay. 2d6 is a 12. Oh, over 5. The English are killed off. And I'm going to say that they move to the top of the wall. Kentuckians will get to fire. They will get to attack. And this is a melee attack, so they're at a 3 on clear, since they're both on top of the wall. We roll a d6 and get a 1, so it's a hit. At least it's a hit. And Kaz will make this roll a minus 3, so a 2 minus 3 is negative 1, so nothing. Okay, New York can fire from wall to wall, so... should I have them fire at those guys? Yeah, I'm going to have them fire at these guys. They got us. It's probably the easiest shot they can make. They get a 9. And a 1d6 is a 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Plus 1. Cos makes it a minus 2. We roll 2d6 and get a 2, so nothing. These foreign troops... let me get these guys spread out a little bit. And I'll say they're going against Toluca. Let's see. Toluca. 8. Okay, they've got an 8 to fire with. And it's clear, so we roll a d6 and get a 6. Automatic miss. Okay, Travis's group will try again. They got the 6-pounder. I'm going to say they're going to fire against Toluca. And we have a 6 against a clear. We roll a d6 and get a 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. It's a hit. Travis makes it a plus 3. We get 11. Okay, Toluca is destroyed. They go back to the 2-turn. And... oh, we need to add a casualty. Okay. The Texians then will fire this Texian unit. They have a 9. And a 9 against a clear. It's that next to last column. They get a 6, automatic miss. Okay, and we have it marked as fired. Okay, these guys are disordered. The Irish are disordered, so they only fight at a plus at a 2 instead of a 4 for firing. They're firing down the wall, so it's clear. We make it a 2, and we get a 6, automatic miss. And then the Missourians will fire down, and they have an 8. It's 1d6 is a 3. 1, 2, 3, plus 1. Okay. 2d6, 3 is 4. Okay, they don't make it. And that is the end of the Texian things. They can take off this disorder now, so we'll delete that. Do I see anything else I'm missing? No, I don't think so. Let's take off the fires. Okay. Now the Mexican units can go. So we will move. These are not in the zone of control, so they're going to hop on top of the wall. They're going to hop on top. Stop. You must not hop on top. Okay, 1, 2, 6. So he's going to make it. He can make it. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, 4. 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. 3, 4, 5. Okay, and I forgot the Texian and the... I forgot that modifier. 2, 3, 4. Let's go. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, I forgot the modifier that since the Mexicans were in the Alamo compound, they got a bit of an advantage. So that's okay. Okay, Jimenez will be over here. These guys are here. Okay, the Texians aren't doing too bad. They've already destroyed quite a few Mexican positions, but they've made it a round and a half without taking too bad a heat. So, okay, let's start here with San Luis against this unknown unit, and they've got a 9. And I'm just going to go ahead and use my handy-dandy combat results chart here. I think you guys get the gist of how to use a CRG at this point. So we'll go, it's a clear shot with a 9. We roll a d6 and get a 1. Oof, that's plus 4, plus 5. So we get an 8 and a 5 easily deletes these guys. Okay, we make a check against Dickerson's guys here. So we've got a 9 and we roll a d6 and get a 4. A 9 and a 4 is a plus 1. We roll 2d6 plus so we get 2d6, we add 3, and then 4 for being in the Alamo. 3 and 4, and 1 is 5. So we add 9 and 5. Okay, and is that, yeah, that's 9 and 5 is 14. So they had a morale of 9, so yeah, they're deleted. And they'll move in here, and that'll kill Dickerson off. So we'll delete Dickerson. Jimenez will be fighting here at a 9. And they are fighting across that fence. So that's a 9. That's this column. And that's a 1. Ooh, 3. Plus 3. And then they get plus 4. 9 plus 4 is 13. Way over 9 there. Delete that, and they move in. Okay. Down here, Kaz gets to go against the Kentuckians. And the Kentuckians will... Let's see. Kaz gets to go against the Kentuckians. Let's see. There's... Aldama goes. I'm sorry. Aldama has a 9. And we roll for the 9, and we get a 3. This is clear terrain. 1, 2, 3 is a plus 2. And then Kaz adds plus 3, so that's plus 5, and plus 1 for the general demoralization is plus 6. We roll 2d6, 9 plus 6, delete. Oh. Yeah, the Texians are taking it bad right now. Okay, Matamor will fire up on Travis. It's a 9. We are in the church wall, however. And we roll a d6 and get a 4. So it's a hit. They get a plus 1. Minus 3 is minus 2. 9 minus 2 is 7 against the units are Texian, so that doesn't affect them. Okay. Aldama, firing up at Ireland, is a 9. And they're firing to the top of the wall. And that's a 6, automatic miss. And Amat is firing with a 10. The Zapadores are going to fire with a 10. They're in clear terrain. We roll a d6 and get a 3. 1, 2, 3. It's a plus 3. Plus 6 for Amat. And then plus 1 for General is a plus 7. 4 and 7. Easily the Irish are eliminated. And then San Luis will fight the Missourians. They have a 7. Clear terrain. We roll a 5. That is a hit. Okay, they get a plus 1. 12 plus 1 eliminates the Missourians. Okay. That is it for that round. Okay, so what we do is there's nobody disrupted. I'll take off the fire markers and the move markers. I'll go down to my return tracks. And these guys will get to come back. These guys get forward 1. You can see that pretty quickly when things fail, they fail fast. And I'm just going to move these guys in where you shouldn't put them in where they started, but I'm just going to put them where their column numbers are, just to make it interesting. Okay, four. Let's put a four clear over here. Now, the biggest problem I think I see with this game is there's just too few units. I think it feels like you just have a little skirmish between units. I think if I were going to change the game up again, I would probably double the number of units, make them smaller, just so it feels a little bit more like there's the Texians are up against a harder foe. It's also got a little bit overly complicated combat resolution system, which I think kind of slows the thing down. This game probably lasts longer than the real battle. Okay, I think I got everybody moved where I need to. I need to move my turn marker. Move it to turn three. It's going to be over pretty quick because the Texians are pretty much at a loss. Okay, Crockett and his guys are going to stay here and fire. Let's see. This is the movement phase. Not much I can... Actually, I'm going to fire down here. I'm going to fire at Jimenez, and I'm going to move the Kentuckians up here to try to keep that. Bonham will stay there. The New Yorkers will stay there. We don't want to get into a melee fight with the Texians if we can avoid it. Actually, I'm going to move this guy. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And I'm going to move this guy. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That just reminds me, I need to get away from those guys. Oh, we got to get off the wall. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's do that. Travis, I'm going to make him go down with the ship. He's going to try to fire again. So, not much left. Okay, here goes Crockett. Let's start with him. He's going to try to fire on these guys, and he can use this 8-pounder. 8-pounder has a 7. We get a 5. And that's a counterfire. Ooh, okay. So San Luis goes with a 9 across a wooden wall. So we roll a d6 and get a 5, which is a hit. Now we roll a 2d6. He gets a plus 1 minus Crockett's 3, so minus 2. 6, not enough. next turn. Okay, now we can move these guys here. We can move these guys here. We move game turn to 4. And so these guys will get to get on the map. Okay, I'm going to put these guys at a 3, 1, 3, 2, and I'm just going to put these guys with Castriel there. Okay, so these guys are on 3 and 2. Salas we'll put up here with the 3s. And we'll put the Aldamas. We'll put them over at the 4s just because that's where the other guys have been coming in. Okay. Remove that. Remove our moves. Now the Texians are... Oh, we can take out this disorder. Oops. It always does that. Delete. Okay. What can the Texians do? Well, here they'll have to fight. Here, I think we're going to use this guy to kind of, again, protect Crockett. Kent will fight. Bowie will stay where he's putting. Bonham will fight. This guy will go over to the 4-pounder. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6-pounder. This guy can't move. This guy can't move. This guy can't move. Actually, Crockett can move. Yeah, he's in a good position here, so we'll stay put. There's 7, a 4, that's a hit, 8, And plus 2 is 9, 10. These guys fall. Okay. So we're left with the Kentuckians and Crockett. Castro can't do anything. I don't think anybody else can do anything. So that is the end of the Mexican round, or the Mexican phases. So we move these guys here. San Luis comes in. Jimenez, let's see, 0. He comes in at, we're going to say up at 4. Let's move him to 4. We're going to move our game turn marker. Take off these, take off the moves. Mexicans, delete that, put him here. They can't be on top of each other, so. Okay. Crockett is in a fight against Salas. He's got a, he needs a 2, gets a 3, and that's not going to be enough. Oh, that's a counterfire. So Salas gets to go. And Salas has a 7. We get a 4 with a 7. Across a wall. It is a hit. And then we add a 1 and a 2, and we subtract 3. So minus 1. So 5, 4, not enough. Okay. Then the Kentuckians get a go. And they have a, first, they can't use the 5-pounder. They have a 3. Okay, let's see, a 3 on a clear terrain. They get a 1. Okay, so they get a hit in on Jimenez. We roll 2d6 and get a 4, so it's not going to be anything. And then the New Yorkers are going to fire with their cannon. They first of all with their 6. They get a 2 out of clear terrain, and a 2 is a, well, it's a plus 1. So they get a plus 1, minus 1 is a 0, so 2d6, 3, nothing. Then they can do with their 9, and they got a 4. That's a plus 1, minus 1, so we roll another 4. They don't do anything. Okay, that is the end of the Texians. We then can attack with the Mexican units. We'll move him here. Morales will go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Aldama will fire over. And then these guys will fire on Crockett. Actually, I'm going to fire on... I think I can, let's see, are these within 7? 1, 2, 3, 4, well, we'll start with Crockett. Let's try to get him out. Koss will stay here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Matamor's over here with a gun. Castillo, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. Everybody's firing on Crockett here. Let's start with the, Salas. Okay, Salas is got a 7. And they get a 5, so they miss. Okay, Toluca has an 8, and this is on clear. They get a 6, so they miss. Castile fires with a 9. And a 9 on a 6, I'm going to say is, I'm going to say that's on the wall. So let's see, 9 and 6, did I say 6? Yeah, 6, they miss. Amat is going to use the Zapadores, and they have a 10, and we'll say on the wall again, a 2. Okay, a 10 and a 2 is a plus 3. They get a plus 6, plus 7, minus 3 is plus 4, and a 10. Okay, that takes, oops, that's going to delete that guy. So Crockett's left. See if Crockett's killed this turn. Yep, there he is. He was killed with a 1. Okay. Okay, so then that leaves Toluca. I'll say they can fire down there. Yeah, they can fire down that line. So with a 7 on a clear terrain, they get a 6. It's a miss. San Luis with a 7 gets a 2, which gives them a plus 1. So they get a plus 2. 8, 9, 10. Okay, nothing. And finally, Jimenez with a 9 gets a 6 and misses. Okay, Morales with a 9. And they get a 1. Okay, so a 9, a top wall, though, is a plus 1. And then they get a plus 3, plus 4. 2d6 plus 4, 6 is 10. Still not enough. Okay, Aldama. Let's see, they're going to use a 7-pounder. So a 7 on top of the wall is a 6 and misses. And then Aldama, they're going to use their fire, an 8. 6 misses. Wow, a lot of 6s. Okay, San Luis with a 6 gets a 4. It's a hit. They get a plus 1. 6, 7, not enough. Aldama with an 8. They get a 1. Okay, an 8 and a 1 is a plus 3, so they get a plus 4. 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, taking out the New Yorkers. Okay. That's the end of the round. We go to the next game turn. Oh, I forgot to move these Mexican units. Not really going to matter a lot. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And that's it, I guess. Okay. Kentuckians can't move. I'm going to just basically form a firing squad here. We'll move them here. He can move to the 6-pounder here. Actually, we're going to move him, the 8, to the 6-pounder. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, and like I say, pretty much all's over but the crying, but we'll... 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and... Actually, this should probably be 4. Okay. Who's going to fire? And this guy's going to come out here, and we'll fire with the 6-pounder. He'll be with the 6-pounder. Okay, Kentuckians. They get to at least try a 1 against Jimenez. They've got a 3 on clear. They get a 4, and that's not enough. Okay. Jimenez is going to go with a 9. They get a 1. Okay, so a 9 and a 1 is a plus 4, plus 5. 6 and 5 is 11, so that puts him into disorder and flips him. Okay, San Luis. I'm going to get this disorder out of here. It doesn't really matter. San Luis has a 7. They're going to fire... They get a 2, and that is going to be a plus 2. Play get a plus 3, 6, 7, 8, nothing. Okay, 7. They get a plus 6 and miss. Amat has a 10, and they roll a 5. That's a plus 1. And then they get a plus 3, so plus 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And that's going to be enough to delete him. So that is the end. Okay, then we figure up how many points the Texians get. They get 8 points for the Mexican losses, and they get 6 points for making it six turns. So they get 8 and 6. They get 14 points. And I look that up under Alamo Victory and Death. Here we go. Let's find it. 14. It's a marginal... No, okay. Yeah, marginal Texian victory. So they were able to hold the Mexicans off just long enough. Anyway, this is the first of the Alamo games that I've got. All three of them are a little bit problematic, I think. I don't know if they're all the greatest games, but they're kind of fun. It's an area that could probably be done again. And maybe when I get done with all these games, I'll throw all the different Alamo games together into a single cobbled together game and see if I can come up with something that might be interesting. And if you're interested in that, let me know. Again, I thank you guys for watching all these. I really appreciate all the good comments and just all the information that people have to give me. That's all I got this week. Next week, I'm going to try to do Texas Glory, and we'll see you then. Thanks a lot, and bye.